With a basic understanding of coherence, we're ready to talk about simulators. But before we dive deeper, let's clear some terminology. A simulator in coherence is the equivalent of what sometimes we refer to as a server. If you're thinking about running logic on the server, within coherence that means running that logic on a simulator. In the context of our Unity SDK, a simulator takes the form of a headless Unity executable, so without graphics, generally running in the Coherence cloud. The fact that it's a Unity executable means that it can run Unity code, so you can do pathfinding, run physics, or run the whole gameplay code if you want. This makes a simulator very different from the replication server, which is a smart relay built by Coherence. The replication server is designed to be as lightweight as possible and is not made in Unity. For this reason, if you want to run calculations or gameplay code of any sort, and you can't run them on clients, you might need a simulator. Finally, it's worth mentioning that in the same way as you can test multiplayer gameplay locally on your machine by launching a local replication server, you can also run a simulator locally. But first, let's see how to build one and upload it to the Coherence cloud. Creating a simulator to run in the Coherence cloud is generally pretty straightforward. We collected all of the needed steps in one place. Open the Coherence hub and go to the Simulators tab. At the top, you have a few options you can configure, like for instance the scenes to include in the simulator build. You most probably want headless mode to be enabled, so the build will run without graphics. There are also a few optimization options. You can explore and optionally turn them on, but they're not fundamental while we test. In the next section, we need to specify a so-called simulator slug. That is, a name that will let us identify the simulator once it's uploaded to the Coherence cloud. Before we hit the build button, we need to check one more thing. To ensure that, when the simulator instance is run in the cloud with no human interaction, it connects to the replication server, we need to add some code to do it. But fortunately, Coherence comes with a pre-made script called Auto-Simulator Connection, which you can instantiate in the scene by simply clicking this button. If you have any of Coherence Connection UIs in the scene, you can safely turn them off, but they won't give you problems if you forget to do so. With the scene now ready to go, let's quickly just check that the netcode is correctly baked, and then we can hit the Build and Upload Headless Linux Client button. After the necessary build time, Coherence uploads the build directly to the Coherence cloud. Finally, it asks if we want to restore the project to its previous settings. This is fundamental if we plan to keep working and we need to build a client, as it's very probable. So let's say yes, and Coherence will remove the pre-compilation directive and bring the project back to being a regular client. Now we can jump back to the Coherence cloud tab, and from there, open the dashboard for this project. Then we can go to Rooms and enable simulators for them. Now let's go back to the editor, hit play, and connect. By selecting the Coherence bridge, we will be able to see that in addition to the client running in the editor, a simulator is also connected. And going back to the Coherence dashboard, we can now go to Rooms and then Recent Rooms, and we will find the logs for the simulator. Clicking on it allows us to explore it, and we can see at the bottom that it had connected successfully. And this is how simple it can be to build and run a simulator in the Coherence cloud. It is, however, a bit useless at the moment. Let's see how to create behavior that runs on it. Coherence offers several ways to create code and gameplay run by a simulator. The first option is to prepare a connected prefab that can only and ever be run server-side. This is a great choice for many types of entities, from game managers to an interactive treasure chest to any object that players don't need to control directly. In this simplified example, we've created a timer that the simulator uses to keep track of the elapsed time from the beginning of a match. To set it up, it's as simple as configuring its simulateIn property to server-side on the Coherence sync. Now, when we press play, if we connect as a client and for any reason the object is in the scene or is instantiated, it will immediately be deactivated. If a simulator is running though, they will take ownership of the object and run its code. Even trying to cheat from the Unity editor, a client won't be able to take control of this entity. You will notice that if we disconnected and reconnected before the room's timeout runs out, we will see that the simulator has advanced the time while we were disconnected, as one would expect. Another way to create behavior on the server is to write code in a way that runs differently depending on where it is executed. There are two ways to achieve this. We can either use the pre-compilation directive coherence_simulator and wrap code in it that we only want to ever run server-side. For instance, you can wrap the update loop of a component in these tags and leave other parts out so that the component can be present and run on all clients, but it will contain more functionality when executed on the simulator. This is a great way to hide sensitive code from the game client, since when creating a client build, it will simply not be compiled. And finally, we also have the option to create branching in the code based on a simple if check. We can ask at any point if the entity running the code is connected as a simulator or not by using simulator utility .isSimulator, which will return true or false. This might be more convenient than the coherence_simulator pre-compilation directive sometimes, if the switches in code are frequent and more articulated, or if they need to be combined with other checks. It's worth mentioning that simulators can also be run locally for testing purposes. You can create a local build and run it on your machine, and there are tools for that at the bottom of the simulator tab of the Coherence Hub. Or another option is to run the editor as a simulator, so you can use all the power of Unity's inspector and logging tools. All of these is extensively explained in the related page in our documentation, Simulators Local Development. This concludes our first video about simulator basics, how to build one and how to tell a simulator apart from a client in code. In the next one, we'll talk about how to use simulators to drive server authoritative gameplay, that is, when the clients are only providing inputs and the simulator is elaborating the whole gameplay state. While that is a somewhat more challenging way to use simulators, it might be needed for competitive games. See you in the next video.